Hi, I'm Tracey Hamilton, and I'd like to welcome you to the Norfolk Air Show, held here at Old Buckenham Airfield. It's 2013, and it's our 70th anniversary celebration. So don't worry if you didn't get here, because I have an all-access pass, and I'm going to take you all through the highlights of this fabulous weekend. So let's go.
Really, they should have been using SOS all the time.
I'm always worried about flying this airplane. I mean, it's such a fantastic piece of aviation history.
It's a fabulous day out for all the family, and you're seeing world-class aerobatics and beautiful flying machines.
But interestingly, it's a lot of the American Air Force people that came over in the Second World War. One of the things they commented on in particular was the lush greenness of Great Britain. We now know why, don't we?
Exactly, yeah.
We are here with the magnificent Jerry Honey. He is the chief flying instructor here at the Old Buckenham Airfield. Please tell us what it would be like as a passenger to go up with you.
As a passenger to go up?
As a passenger to go up in the steerman.
Well, you'd have to take part in the flight, because people don't just fly with me. They take part in the flight and have a go at flying the aircraft itself. So it would be, for many people it would be different. For others it would be something that they've always wanted to do. And yes, we do it. We make things happen, put it that way.
So I heard that you had 12 flights today that were flight lessons.
Yes, if I'm counting correctly, I believe it was. I lost count after a little while, actually, but probably about 12, yeah.
Can you also tell me, I heard that you do aerobatics in this as well.
I do. Not today, because it takes a little while for this old bird to get up high enough to do some aerobatics. And 15-minute flight wasn't enough. I did. One lady bought a double ticket.
Oh, my.
And she said, I've got to turn upside down with an old-age pensioner over in Norfolk. So there we go.
I guess every person's a little different.
Always happy to oblige.
Well, that's wonderful. Well, you can book a pleasure flight with Jerry Honey whenever you like. He's fabulous. Come visit him at the Old Buckenham Airfield. We're here with Matt Wilkins, the manager of the Old Buckenham Airfield, who's put on this incredible event. And I wanted to ask Matt, what's different this year than last year? What new people do you have here?
Well, I don't sleep for another day. Usually it's a one-day event,
but we have hundreds. Of, I think last year 500 classic cars for a start, and over 100 military vehicles. And there isn't time to see all those and the air displays. So we've got lots of people whinging at me. And basically, we've created this second day. The other thing that people really like to do is to actually go and take to the skies themselves. So by getting in this extra day, we've been able to have various aircraft, including 1941 Stearman biplane, PA-28s, which you would learn to fly in, and so forth. And a lot of people have been able to go flying today who would otherwise not have gone flying at all during a normal air show.
So did you book a lot of pleasure flights today and some trial flights as well?
Yeah, well, there'd be lots of trial lessons, and we sold out.
Wonderful.
Oh, well, yeah, it was pretty good go. We certainly sold out of the Boeing Stearman, and the helicopter that was running around doing pleasure flights as well. It was flat out all day long. So it's worked very well.
And what's New Year's this year? I think the beer festival is new for you, isn't it?
Well, that's absolutely excellent. We like to keep things local as possible. So we've got a lot of beers with an aviation theme from Wolf, the local brewery. So it couldn't really work out much better. And a 1940s hangar dance, which is a new venture and has already worked out very, very well in forward ticket sales.
We're really excited about the hangar dance tonight, and we're excited to hear the harmony bells. We heard them earlier today. We know they have something special planned for us this evening.
We've also got the Swing Machine Band. It's a 17-piece big band, so that should be pretty loud, if nothing else. And DJ Texas Tommy, who in Norfolk circles is a bit of a god for 1940s music.
Oh, my. How long are we going to be out tonight?
Well, at least till midnight. We kick everyone out at midnight, basically.
All right, so stay tuned for later, and we'll take you to the hangar dance.
Once again, thanks to everybody involved in putting together the Old Buckenham Air Show, and of course to people like the Air Cadets, because they're standing out there. I'm sure they're still out there in the rain. Yes, they're well equipped, though. They all get issued with a uniform, and I was assured by some Air Cadets yesterday it's well and truly waterproof. So thanks to all the air cadets, all the volunteers, everybody involved in pulling together an air show like this. It's a jigsaw puzzle. We all come together, we all play our part, and we have a wonderful time. And of course, as I'm talking, the rain is tracking through, but it's brightening.
Hi, I don't know if you know, but Old Buckenham has a mobile control tower, which I think is absolutely fascinating. Everybody's used to a stationary control tower. I'm going to go in here and see if the guys can give us some background information about what goes on. Here we go. Guys, are you in here? Hi, we're here in the control tower with Ian McDowell. Can you tell us what it is like, the difference between a regular day today and also an event like today?
Yeah, sure. Today, really, because of the air display, all of the aircraft movements or visiting aircraft are all bunched towards the beginning of the day, and we get very busy in the morning because they're all coming here to attend the display itself. Then we have the air display, and then it gets very busy at the end of the day again when all of those aircraft depart again.
And how many people do you usually have in the control tower?
Normally we would only have one on a normal working day, but today, because of various emergency procedures and because of the busyness of the traffic situation, we normally have a minimum of two in the tower and a second pair of eyes to help us spot other aircraft and a third person on standby and to offer brakes for other people.
And when do you know what runway to choose?
Well, that's all dependent on the wind, really. We've had a very strong southwesterly today, so we've been using the southwesterly runway. But if it does vary, we have other grass runways that we can use so that aircraft can take off and land into the wind.
Well, thank you so much for your time. We appreciate it.
You're welcome.
I'm here with Adrian Willis, who is the chief instructor at the British Aerobatic Academy. He takes people up in incredible trial lessons, and I'd like him to tell us what a passenger could expect to take an aerobatic lesson with Adrian.
Well, the aerobatic trial lessons are really an insight into what a proper lesson, a proper course of aerobatics would entail. And we'd normally tailor it to each individual. So we'd start off very gently and then gradually ramp up the severity of the G-forces, the severity of the movements, so that the pupil actually lands having done at least as much as they expected, but wanting no more. So try to time it perfectly so that they're not actually physically ill, but they've thoroughly enjoyed it and hopefully learned a great deal as well.
Can you tell us a little bit about G-force?
G-force, well, when you pull the stick back, you experience G, and this aircraft is limited to plus or minus 10 G.
The extra 200.
That's right, yes. And the human body pretty much gives up if you sustain that for any significant length of time. So we have various maneuvers, various muscle contractions that we use to delay the onset of G. So basically, a normal aerobatic lesson, you'd expect to pull between 6 and 8 G. And so your head will feel 8 times its normal weight. And
oh my goodness.
It sounds
exhilarating.
Well, it is exhilarating. A Formula One driver might experience 3.5 to 4 G. A competition aerobatic pilot with 9 or 10 G. But it does take a bit of time to build up the tolerance for it.
So tell us why the British the Academy of Aerobatics.
Well, the British Aerobatic Academy is the finest aerobatic training institution, if you like, certainly in the country, and I personally think Europe as well. We train competition pilots. Oh, this is any PPL pilot who has a desire to do aerobatics, but we also teach display pilots as well. In fact, three of us from Little Grandston are displaying here today.
I'm here with Lauren Richardson, the youngest British aerobatic pilot for 2012. She's very fabulous and she's got a lot of fun stories to tell us today. Lauren, you're 26 years old and you've done so much by now. Tell us a little bit about your past experiences.
Well, it's all been quite hard work, really. You know, and the whole flying thing is amazingly challenging, and it's just something I kind of fell into and decided I loved. So I've just been pushing harder and harder to just become a better pilot, and here I am doing all this kind of stuff. It's a bit mad, really. But
one of the things I love, the stories about your mom, is that I went up in the steerman and I did a trial flight, and I had to call my mother after, and she was traumatized. So I totally understand about your mother getting white knuckles, and now that you rock climb and ice climb as well. You're quite a daredevil in the family.
Yeah, apparently so. People tend to call me, what is it, the term adrenaline junkie. I've always gone, no, it's not true, it's not true. But if you see the motorbike that I ride to go and fly this, you'd think, yeah, maybe she's lying. But
can you tell me what your favourite thing is about flying?
I don't know, it's just the freedom and the fact that you can go up. I mean, flying this kind of aeroplane, you can literally go and do whatever your kind of imagination says you fancy doing. You could, you know, those dreams you have where you're flying and kind of just doing whatever. Right. But you can actually do that.
Right.
And it's just fantastic. Being able to look upwards and see the floor.
Yeah.
It's kind of surreal and just, I just think.
Well, I love that you could also look downwards and see people's faces while you're flying.
Yeah, no, that's a very cool feeling, yeah. Actually. Watching and having people waving at you as you're flying is like, oh, it's just amazing. Just amazing.
Well, she's absolutely fantastic and we're going to have to keep an eye on her. Thank you so much for talking to me.
No problem.
So Lauren is in the red and white pits with the red and white checkerboard tail. She's there, checking everything, full and free movement of controls, doing all her pre-flight checks as she taxis along.
There is
Aircraft we have seen for many years at RAF displays. It was the mainstay of a lot of RAF displays during the 1970s that flew Jet Provost. The Jet Provost was, at some point, the RAF's basic trainer. Like a lot of early jets, early ones were hampered by a lack of range. They say there's no such thing as a slow roll in an early Jet Provost because you run out of fuel. This particular aircraft is Jet Provost Mark V. It was much upgraded. You notice also that this aircraft has tip tanks. Bit of extra fuel in the wings. Early Jet Provosts were nicknamed by the RAF constant thrust variable noise. It didn't really seem to matter what you did with the throttle too much. It always went at one speed because to do anything you had to have the throttle fully forward. This, the 5, is much more powerful. And Andy was saying earlier on, you actually have to hold it back in displays, otherwise it is stonking down the runway much too quickly. So as he climbs off, he's heading back now to Duxford. Some black and white aeroplanes. This is two pits and the Edge 540. S2s. These are S2Bs. Mentioned Lauren earlier on was flying an S1S. The one stands for single seat. These two aircraft are both two seat. Very, very capable aircraft. Very, very aerobatic. Can turn you upside down, throw you about all over the place, and make you wish wish you hadn't had lunch. This is the Wildcat aerobatic team. So what's going to happen? Are they going to break? What, get your cameras ready. Here they go for a break. Now you see the fantastically fast rate of roll on the Edge. The Edge 540 is made in the USA. The wing is carbon fiber, so it is incredibly strong. This aircraft is tested to 20 G, 20 times the force of gravity. So as I mentioned earlier on, an 8-stone person at 20 G would weigh 1 ton. So coming in over the top, picking up the line, accelerating down. The 540 comes from the engine, the IO 540. That's 540 cubic inch flat seat. And if you look to your right, you have the two pits. Wildcat 1 is being flown by Al Coutts. He spent a short time in the RAF in the 1980s and gained his civilian pilot wings in Switzerland in 1992. It says here he quickly became very interested in the dark side of aviation, or aerobatics as it's usually known, and he built a single seat pit special from drawings. Wildcat 2 is being flown by Willie Cruikshank. He flew his first solo at the age of 14 in an air training corps glider. Like I said, kids, if you want to get involved, you can do it. He went into the RAF in 1985 and has flown Buccaneers alongside today's display director Tom Eales, as well as Jaguars as the boss of number 6 squadron, and he was the last station commander at RAF Coltishall. Did over 100 operational missions in the Balkans and the Middle East, and commanded operations in Afghanistan. So just taken off was Matt Summers. There he is, pulling up over the top of there. As I mentioned earlier on, the RV8 is a home-built aeroplane. There is a wonderful organisation in this country called the Light Aircraft Association. They oversee the manufacture and operation of home-built, kit-built and out-of-production aircraft, such as crusty old things like the old aeroplane I've got. They're a wonderful organisation that make it very easy for people to go flying. They cut a lot of the bureaucracy out of things, and they still maintain the professional levels, allowing people to make aircraft just like this very aircraft you see before you in the comfort of their own home, he says, standing in under the rain. There are now, I believe, a total of 9 different Vans aircraft, RV1 through to 9. This particular one is a 2-seat tandem, so one in front of the other. And they all have really very, very good performance through good aerodynamic design. In all, some 8,000 RV models have been built worldwide, and it's the most popular type of kit-built aircraft ever. Now, to give you an idea what they're like, this will have a maximum speed of 230 miles an hour, of 150 horsepower to 180 horsepower, depending on the model. Weighs just 840 kilograms. It will take off in 84 meters. And has a range of over 1,000 miles, and at 160 miles an hour it will give you 30 miles a gallon. Now, I arrived here yesterday from all the way from Weston-super-Mare. My old Honda CRV was definitely not giving that much. I wish I had one of these. So here he is rolling it over, inverted pass down the runway. Again, we mentioned this is a lovely thing after seeing some of the extreme aerobatics we saw just now. It's an example of using energy management to keep the display going. He hasn't got the real oomph that some of the other aircraft had. It's a lovely slow roll there as he's going down the runway. Just as an aside, I rebuilt an old aeroplane, but building your own aeroplane is very similar. Somebody said to me, what does it cost? And I made a joke of it, but as I heard the joke coming out, I realised that what I was saying was actually the truth. And what I said was there are 3 numbers with every aeroplane build. The first is the figure that you own up to your partner. The second is the figure that you reluctantly own up to yourself when you wake up in the middle of the night screaming. And the third one is what it actually cost you, which is probably number 1 and number 2 added together. Partially kit-built aircraft such as this comes partially assembled, make it a lot easier. And of course you have the choice of what equipment you fit to it. There are Vans aircraft flying with virtually glass cockpits, very high-tech stuff. I've just been asked if I need an umbrella. I don't need an umbrella. I'm a roughy, toughy commentator. Ha! Besides, I'm standing in a tent. The RVA actually came into production in 1996, and complete kits were available by 1998. Now, Matt had his first taste of aviation when he was just 7 years old and quickly caught the bug. It happens to us. By 16, he was regularly flying gliders solo. And by 18 years old, he had his national private pilot's license. So again, I've been saying it all day, guys, young kids, you know, any age, if you're interested in aviation, it can be done. He's now just 26, same age as Lauren. And much of his aviation career is centered around aerobatics, starting out in the T-67 Firefly and then moving on to the Extra 200, like we saw earlier. In 2008, he won his first and only aerobatics competition before deciding to focus on developing his skills by learning to fly in close formation with current and ex-military pilots. Power back, slowing the aeroplane down. Get the nose up, get the speed bled off, and he'll be bringing that into land. Another thing I am going to mention, because I've just seen it written on the tail and I should have mentioned it earlier, the Aviators support Fly to Help. Fly to Help is a great organisation that provides one-off experiences for people that are sick or ill, or you know, the sort of people that deserve a break. It's Fly to Help, so, and you can look it up. flytohelp.org. They do an awful lot of very, very good work for people who've not having the best of times, and the Aviators are doing a lot to help promote them, so good for them.
Hi, we're here with Steve Jones, who's just flown in the most famous plane in the world, the MH-434 Spitfire. You've probably seen this plane in A Bridge Too Far, Battle of Britain, and Hope and Glory, and he's graciously flown it in the most fabulous way. This is pretty much like a museum piece. Are you ever worried about flying this plane?
I'm always worried about flying this airplane. I mean, it's such a fantastic piece of aviation history. But you have to be super careful with it. But it's a marvelous machine, you know, 1943 Mark 9 Spitfire. And pretty much as it is here today, it's pretty much as it was in 1943. So it's an absolute artifact, treasured artifact.
How is it that it's 70 years old and it's actually flying so vigorously, more than most?
Well, I think because people look after it very well. I mean, it's got a long history of being owned by and operated by the Hanna family, Ray Hanna, Mark Hanna. Mm-hmm. So they looked after it very well, but also flew it very, you know, beautifully and aggressively as it should have been flown. But they've just looked after it very well, and we're trying to do the same thing, look after it just as well as they did.
What do you love about the 27-litre engine?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's one of the loveliest piston engines ever built. Sadly, unless you're in the thing, you don't get to hear the real noise of it, but it's marvellous, little tiny short exhaust stubs, so great. One of the nicest things is starting the engine and hearing that Merlin growl.
The Rolls-Royce Merlin, correct?
The Rolls-Royce Merlin.
I know my planes. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Now smoke on, he's rolling in, accelerating in towards us. Now watch as he comes, he's bound to use the roll rate. Yes, there he is, rolling it in on the way in. Having wound it up, he wound it back the other way. Accelerating hard down, down to around about 200 odd mile an hour. Pulling hard at the bottom.
Goodwin, who's been flying for 33 years, and he's going to tell us about his Pitts S2S. Richard, about 3 weeks ago, was this actually on the garage floor?
In quite a few bits, yes, on the garage floor. I'll just give you a bit of a brief history and resume of the aeroplane.
Please.
I bought it 9 months ago, specifically with the intention of modifying it for the UK airshow circuit. It's very popular in America, flown by a couple of very good aerobatic pilots, and it produces an exceptional display, but the airplane needs to be modified, and that's what I've been doing for the last 9 months. To summarize the modifications, the undercarriage has been changed, titanium gear has been fitted to make it lighter and more streamlined, and there's been serious modifications to the engine and propeller and the induction system and the fuel injection system.
And how was it flying today?
Very blustery, hard to maintain position, and I had to adapt my display slightly. But I hope you enjoyed it. It's a shame you didn't get too much footage of it. But as you can see, the modifications produce quite an impressive performance from takeoff to landing. It's a fantastic aeroplane to fly, I've only got, I first flew it again since all the modifications on the 28th of May, so I have very limited time on it at the moment, and I'm sure this plane's going to get a lot better.
Well, it's a very sexy plane, so good, well done.
Well, thank you very much. Probably sexier than me.
We're here with Ted Sinclair, who is a wonderful part of a group of Norfolk enthusiasts to recreate the Titanic radio room. I'm going to ask him about the SOS signal and the Marconi radio. Ted, can you tell us the significance of the SOS signal and how it was translated through the Marconi radio?
Yes, the SOS signal that most people are familiar with was actually brought in 1906, which was 6 years before the Titanic disaster. And although Marconi, because he had his own call sign for distress, which was CQD, the operators continued to use that. And when the accident happened, they put out the messages with the CQD in front, but really they should have been using SOS all the time. Eventually one of the operators said to the other one, shall we try the new distress sign SOS? Which was by no means new, and they should have used in the first place. It didn't have any effect on the disaster, but the thing was, this is one of the aspects of it. But
so is it actually a term that was made famous from from the Titanic?
The SOS, yes, I think it was, but most people were under the impression that was the first time it was used. But
yes, I was.
But it certainly wasn't, no.
Thank you so much for your information. Have a great day. Here we have Sean Hindle, who's curator of the East England Military Museum. Sean, it looks like you have an incredible army here, and I was wondering if you could take us around and just tell us some of the important vehicles that you have.
Well, we've got vehicles spanning most of the 1980s and 90s here at the moment, what the British Army have used. We've not got much World War II kit out today. We've got some stuff which is still current and still serving, extremely rare and the only stuff in private hands. But what I'll do is I'll get Steve, who's just left the army, to walk you around and tell you all about them.
I'm so excited, and I also offered to drive this baby over here, so hopefully we're going to get to do that later. Here we are with Steve Garrett, our other curator of this fantastic area, and we have this colossal artillery piece right behind us. He's going to tell us about it.
Yeah, this is the FH-70. It's a self-propelled 155mm artillery piece. Was in use with the British Army until 1995. One of the unique pieces about this equipment is it's got its own little engine. So it can be driven into location when it's unhooked from the truck. If you look behind you, you'd see some of the older artillery pieces that we've got. They had to be manhandled into place.
Didn't you say that this has a Volkswagen engine in it?
It has. It's got a little Volkswagen petrol engine. But you can imagine the size of this thing. If you take it off the back of the truck, you'd need an awful lot of blokes to be able to maneuver it into position.
Exactly.
It's got its own engine. It's run on hydraulics, and it'll drive into place.
I think this is a very exciting vehicle. We also have some tiny tykes back there who are just ready to make it move.
Yeah, we always get a lot of interest on this piece when we display it, purely because of its size. It invokes interest in a lot of young lads.
I think that's fabulous. Where are you taking us to next?
Okay, behind you.
Well, I think this vehicle is very sexy. I can't wait to hear what this vehicle is actually used for.
This is a light strike vehicle. It was used initially by the SAS. This vehicle has actually got provenance that it was used in the first Gulf War. In a similarity to the great big artillery piece we were just talking about, this also runs a Volkswagen engine.
Oh my goodness, that is just so fascinating.
These things run about a nice steady 50 miles an hour, cross country. They'll go pretty much anywhere you want them to. They were designed as a weapons platform. You can see above us, 50 caliber machine gun. They carry a majority of weapons that the SAS would use. Unfortunately, they got taken out of service because they couldn't carry enough equipment that the troops needed.
So you promised that I was going to be able to drive this vehicle later, and I wanted to know everything about it before I actually get in. Tell me about...
Okay, this is another artillery piece. A self-propelled gun. People mistake these as being tanks. They're not.
Oh, I thought it was. That's why we're here.
Yeah. A tank can fire in what's called the direct fire mode. These vehicles have got to stop, aim at their target, and then fire. This is an Abbott self-propelled gun, 105mm. Unfortunately, she's quite an old one. She went out of service in the late 70s, and she was replaced by a wonderful Austrian gun called the M109. Dead simple to drive. Mm-hmm. Two tillers, one pedal.
All right.
pull left to go left, pull right to go right, and just stamp on the pedal to go faster.
All right, well, I'm ready to rock and roll when you are.
I'm ready when you are. Let's go play.
All right, here we go. Hi, we are lucky enough to have Brendon O'Brien here with a scintillating personality, and welcome him to the Norfolk Air Show. Brendon, please tell us about your family circus.
Tracy, first of all, great to see you, and it's wonderful to be here at Old Buckenham. Glorious sunshine, it's a little bit windy. Okay, the flying circus, it's about entertainment, and that's the key word, I guess. People come along to air shows to be entertained, and landing an airplane on top of a truck is kind of what we call flying circus. And it goes back to the days of barnstorming between the wars, the 1920s and the 1930s. So it's a very old, a very great tradition. A lot of it started, of course, in your home country, in the United States of America. My show's a little bit different. It comes under the guise of barnstorming, yeah? Right. You know, landing an aeroplane on top of a truck is basically pure theatre.
And how long have you been doing this?
Ah, yes, a very good question. Now, one never asks a girl her age, but I've been doing it for nearly 50 years.
So there we go, ladies and gentlemen, the bright yellow Piper Cub, trailing smoke there from Brendon. Now, Brendon, No, Brendon, you tend to hold it still. No, that's... No. You'd think somebody with his experience would know better than that, but here he comes. Now, we are hoping that later on Brendon will be able to do something pretty special here, which may qualify him for a Guinness Book of Records record. But, again, the conditions are not exactly brilliant. He was saying before we started that... It was looking very, very bumpy over the trees over there, so he wasn't likely to go particularly low over there. So here he comes. Coming down the runway, pulling up, lots of wiggle on. Now here we go, we have the world's shortest runway with the world's strangest pilot. Is he going to give it a go? He's going to give it a go. He's going to try and get... If he can get onto that, it will qualify as the world's shortest ever landing. He's got his wheels down. Oh, no. No, not quite. Now, instead, he's been distracted by the lesser-spotted snurd warbler again. He's going to go and have another look at that. Flying along. Is he going to give it a go? Oh, no, 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 it's Pyro. Oh, look at that. Now, I think that might be a hint that the trailer driver didn't want him to land on that pass. Got his smoke on, he's there, he's lining up. Timing the run so that he can come down level next to the trailer. Now, are we going to see something from Brendon this time? Are we? Who knows? All sorts of things could happen. Is he going to get on there? He's getting down. Oh, close, close, close. Oh, he's touched down. Is he going to get on it? No. Oh, just a bit too windy. That last gust came. I mean, we can all feel that, that gust that came through right at the end. So, unfortunately, he didn't make it. This is such a shame. So, they'll come past now for another positioning run, and the trailer will go and park up. But wave to Brendon. He's going to be... in close and waving. He'll be leaning out the window. So, talk to the organiser. Matt, is he going to be doing it next year?
Yes.
There was the voice of authority. We don't argue with Matt. He is going to be doing it next year. But that's such a shame that the weather's bad. But Brendan's, he's not bad at this, really. Next item up is going to be the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. He's running in. There's no smoke with this one. Running in right in front of the contribution. Crowd centre is Rod Dean. He's put his landing light on in the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. Now, the Bulldog was an aeroplane that was very familiar around RAF airfields from the very early 70s right up until into the 90s. Originally designed by Beagle Aircraft. The first prototype flew in 1969 at Shoreham. And all other aircraft were subsequently built by Scottish Aviation Limited at Prestwick. So if you listen very carefully to the exhaust note, you will hear a very slight Scottish accent. Now, the Bulldog was ordered by a number of air forces as a basic trainer. These included the Swedish Air Force and Army, the air forces of Malaysia, Kenya, Ghana, Nigeria, Jordan, breathe in, Lebanon, Botswana, and the Royal Hong Kong Auxiliary Air Force. In the UK, the Royal Air Force ordered 130 as a chipmunk replacement with the University Air Squadrons and the Air Experience flights. So a lot of serving RAF air crew would have had their first air experience flights in aeroplanes very similar to, and in fact in, this aeroplane. Now, the Bulldog is a fully aerobatic aircraft with side-by-side seating, powered by a 200 horsepower Lycoming IO360 flat four. That means it's a 360 cubic inch engine and has a constant speed Hartzell two-bladed propeller. Now, just to give you an idea what the conditions are like today, as Rob was just on short finals there, he radioed the next aeroplane and told them that it is very, very bumpy up there. So again, as he comes past, he can see. You can see how much glass he's got to look out of. He's got loads of space to see you. So give him a wave. Now, you'll be pleased to know, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to teach you to suck eggs while the Spitfire's up. I won't give you facts and figures. You can look those up. I'll try and put it in context a bit, but mostly I'm going to let you listen to it, because that is what it's all about, the wonderful noise of that Merlin engine. So, my lards, ladles, jelly moulds and chilblains, lining up at the end of the runway, we have Steve Jones in the old flying machine company Spitfire Mark 9. That, of course, is one of the great sights and sounds of British air shows. Thank you for sticking with us and watching it. I know it's been testing conditions today. We would like to thank you all for coming to the 2013 Old Buckenham Air Show. Remember, there are still things to see. So on behalf of myself, Melvin Hiscock, thank you very much for coming. Stick around, see what's going on. And who knows, I may see you next year.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed what has certainly been the biggest Old Buckenham Air Show we've had to date. In the skies above at the moment, you will see not part of the main display, but more important, perhaps, our Chief Flying Instructor, Wing Commander Jerry Honey, OBE, in our most famous resident, the 1941 Boeing PT Stearman. On board is an extremely lucky Eastern Daily Press winner. Very delighted to have the EDP and Archand as our media partners, who've offered incredibly fabulous support throughout. Particularly would like to thank Steve Maddams of the EDP for his passionate support of us, and we're looking forward to doing the same next year.
We're here with the Wildcat aerobatic team, Willie Cruikshank, David Jenkins, and Al Coots. And David, how do you feel about joining this crazy team of guys?
Well, it's good fun. I've done a lot of aerobatic competition in the past, and this is the first time I've really been involved with a display team. And it's good to contrast the edge with the two pits. So I'm doing all the dynamic stuff. They're doing all the graceful precision formation stuff. And I think it works well because it keeps something in front of the audience the whole time. That's how we designed the display.
So I understand that you started with two planes, with you and Al, and then you added David, and I believe that you bought two more planes. So are you looking to expand at this point?
We have. We've got another one of these pits. It's currently red. Hope to get it painted like this by the end of the year, and the pilot's just starting his work up for that. And then we'll see where we go from there. Hopefully we'd end up with four pits, maybe four on the edge, or maybe just four pits. We'll see how we get on.
Can you tell us the quick story? I know that Al is a cattle farmer, and you were a group captain. How you guys actually got together? I think that's really interesting.
Well, yeah, I was in the Air Force. Al's been in the Air Force before before taking up all this other stuff he's been doing. And we have a mutual friend who's an expert Arrows pilot, and then he was the boss of the Battle Britain Memorial flight. And when I left the Air Force, I said, I'm coming back to Norfolk, and I want to get into this sort of flying. And he said, I've got a chum there called Al. You should speak to him. And that's where it all started. And we've been flying for about the last 2 or 3 years working up to this.
Well, this is a fantastic team. I hope you'll come out to the field and visit these three magnificent men.
In their flying machines.
And their flying machines. This is Brian, our safety manager at Old Buckenham Airfield, and I wanted to find out what a day in the life of Brian is. What was today like for you?
Today was busy, but organized.
Right.
Uneventful, which is what we're looking for.
No emergencies?
No emergencies that I'm aware of. One or two minor incidents, but nothing to be alarmed about.
All right. Well, if you have this man in your corner, you know you're safe. So thank you for being with us today.
You're absolutely welcome.
Here we are at the United States Army Air Force Memorial, Station 144. Think back to December 1943. Jimmy Stewart, Hollywood film legend, was actually an executive officer here, as well as Walter Matthau. This memorial is to commemorate the 366 men that lost their lives at Old Buckenham. This is a beautiful memorial. We hope you come and visit it. Well, it's the end of our weekend. I'm absolutely windswept. I'm rained on. I had the most fantastic time. I hope I showed you a good time. And we look forward to seeing you in 2014. Thanks for being here. Bye.
with the red and white checkerboard tail. She's there checking everything, full and free movement of controls, doing all her pre-flight checks as she taxis along. We have seen for many years at RAF displays. It was the mainstay of a lot of RAF displays during the 1970s that flew Jet Provost. The Jet Provost was, at some point, the RAF's basic trainer. Like a lot of early jets, early ones were hampered by a lack of range. They say there's no such thing as a slow roll in an early Jet Provost because you run out of fuel. This particular aircraft is a Jet Provost Mark V. It was much upgraded. You notice also that this aircraft has tip tanks. Bit of extra fuel in the wings. Early Jet Provosts were nicknamed by the RAF constant thrust variable noise. It didn't really seem to matter what you did with the throttle too much. It always went at one speed because to do anything you had to have the throttle fully forward. This, the 5, is much more powerful. And Andy was saying earlier on, you actually have to hold it back in displays, otherwise it is stonking down the runway much too quickly. So as he climbs off, he's heading back now to Duxford. Some black and white aeroplanes. This is two pits and the Edge 540. S2s. These are S2Bs. Mentioned Lauren earlier on was flying an S1S. The one stands for single seat. These two aircraft are both two seat. Very, very capable aircraft. Very, very aerobatic. Can turn you upside down, throw you about all over the place, and make you wish wish you hadn't had lunch. This is the Wildcat aerobatic team. So what's going to happen? Are they going to break? What? Get your cameras ready. Here they go for a break. Now you see the fantastically fast rate of roll on the edge. The Edge 540 is made in the USA. The wing is carbon fiber, so it is incredibly strong. This aircraft is tested to 20 G, 20 times the force of gravity. So as I mentioned earlier on, an 8-stone person at 20 G would weigh 1 ton. So coming in over the top, picking up the line, accelerating down. The 540 comes from the engine, the IO 540. That's 540 cubic inch flat seat. And if you look to your right, you have the two pits. Wildcat 1 is being flown by Al Coutts. He spent a short time in the RAF in the 1980s and gained his civilian pilot wings in Switzerland in 1992. It says here he quickly became very interested in the dark side of aviation, or aerobatics as it's usually known, and he built a single seat pit special from drawings. Wildcat 2 is being flown by Willie Cruikshank. He flew his first solo at the age of 14 in an air training corps glider. Like I said, kids, if you want to get involved, you can do it. He went into the RAF in 1985 and has flown Buccaneers alongside today's display director Tom Eales, as well as Jaguars as the boss of number 6 squadron, and he was the last station commander at RAF Coltishall. Did over 100 operational missions in the Balkans and the Middle East, and commanded operations in Afghanistan. So just taken off was Matt Summers. There he is, pulling up over the top of there. As I mentioned earlier on, the RV8 is a home-built aeroplane. There is a wonderful organisation in this country called the Light Aircraft Association. They oversee the manufacture and operation of home-built, kit-built and out-of-production aircraft, such as crusty old things like the old aeroplane I've got. They're a wonderful organisation that make it very easy for people to go flying. They cut a lot of the bureaucracy out of things, and they still maintain the professional levels, allowing people to make aircraft just like this very aircraft you see before you in the comfort of their own home, he says, standing in under the rain. There are now, I believe, a total of 9 different Vans aircraft, RV1 through to 9. This particular one is a 2-seat tandem, so one in front of the other. And they all have really very, very good performance through good aerodynamic design. In all, some 8,000 RV models have been built worldwide, and it's the most popular type of kit-built aircraft ever. Now, to give you an idea what they're like, this will have a maximum speed of 230 miles an hour, off 150 horsepower to 180 horsepower, depending on the model. Weighs just 840 kilograms. It will take off in 84 meters. And has a range of over 1,000 miles, and at 160 miles an hour it will give you 30 miles a gallon. Now, I arrived here yesterday from all the way from Weston-super-Mare. My old Honda CRV was definitely not giving that much. I wish I had one of these. So here he is rolling it over, inverted pass down the runway. Again, we mentioned this is a lovely thing after seeing some of the extreme aerobatics we saw just now. It's an example of using energy management to keep the display going. He hasn't got the real oomph that some of the other aircraft had. It's a lovely slow roll there as he's going down the runway. Just as an aside, I rebuilt an old aeroplane, but building your own aeroplane is very similar. Somebody said to me, what does it cost? And I made a joke of it, but as I heard the joke coming out, I realised that what I was saying was actually the truth. What I said was there are 3 numbers with every aeroplane build. The first is the figure that you own up to your partner. The second is the figure that you reluctantly own up to yourself when you wake up in the middle of the night screaming. And the third one is what it actually cost you, which is probably number 1 and number 2 added together. Partially kit-built aircraft such as this comes partially assembled, make it a lot easier. And of course you have the choice of what equipment you fit to it. There are Vans aircraft flying with virtually glass cockpits, very high tech stuff. I've just been asked if I need an umbrella. I don't need an umbrella. I'm a roughy, toughy commentator. Ha. Besides, I'm standing in a tent. The RVA actually came into production in 1996, and complete kits were available by 1998. Now, Matt had his first taste of aviation when he was just 7 years old and quickly caught the bug. It happens to us. By 16, he was regularly flying gliders solo, and by 18 years old, he had his national private pilot's license. So, again, I've been saying it all day, guys, young kids, you know, any age, if you're interested in aviation, it can be done. He's now just 26, same age as Lauren. And much of his aviation career is centered around aerobatics, starting out in the T-67 Firefly and then moving on to the Extra 200 like we saw earlier. In 2008, he won his first and only aerobatics competition before deciding to focus on developing his skills by learning to fly in close formation with current and ex-military pilots. Power back, slowing the aeroplane down. Get the nose up, get the speed bled off, and he'll be bringing. Another thing I am going to mention, because I've just seen it written on the tail and I should have mentioned it earlier, the Aviators support Fly to Help. Fly to Help is a great organisation that provides one-off experiences for people that are sick or ill, or you know, the sort of people that deserve a break. It's Fly to Help, and you can look it up. flytohelp.org. They do an awful lot of very, very good work for people who've not having the best of times, and the Aviators are doing a lot to help promote them, so good for them.
Hi, we're here with Steve Jones, who's just flown in the most famous plane in the world, the MH-434 Spitfire. You've probably seen this plane in A Bridge Too Far, Battle of Britain, and Hope and Glory, and he's graciously flown it in the most fabulous way. This is pretty much like a museum piece. Are you ever worried about flying this plane?
I'm always worried about flying this airplane. I mean, it's such a fantastic piece of aviation history. But yeah, so you have to be super careful with it, but it's a marvellous machine, you know, 1943 Mark 9 Spitfire, and pretty much as it is here today, is pretty much as it was in 1943, so it's an absolute artifact, treasured artifact.
How is it that it's 70 years old and it's actually flying so vigorously, more than most?
Well, I think because people look after it very well. I mean, it's got a long history of being owned by and operated by the Hanna family, Ray Hanna, Mark Hanna. Mm-hmm. So they looked after it very well, but also flew it very, beautifully and aggressively as it should have been flown. But they've just looked after it very well, and we're trying to do the same thing, look after it just as well as they did.
What do you love about the 27-litre engine?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's one of the loveliest piston engines ever built. Sadly, unless you're in the thing, you don't get to hear the real noise of it, but it's marvellous, little tiny short exhaust stubs, so great. One of the nicest things is starting the engine and hearing that Merlin growl.
The Rolls-Royce Merlin, correct?
The Rolls-Royce Merlin.
I know my planes. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Now smoke on, he's rolling in, accelerating in towards us. Now watch as he comes, he's bound to use the roll rate. Yes, there he is, rolling it in on the way in. Having wound it up, he wound it back the other way. Accelerating hard down, now to around about 200 odd mile an hour. Pulling hard at the bottom.
Goodwin, who's been flying for 33 years, and he's going to tell us about his Pitts S2S. Richard, about 3 weeks ago, was this actually on the garage floor?
In quite a few bits, yes, on the garage floor. I'll just give you a bit of a brief history and resume of the aeroplane.
Please.
I bought it 9 months ago, specifically with the intention of modifying it for the UK airshow circuit. It's very popular in America, flown by a couple of very good aerobatic pilots, and it produces an exceptional display, but the airplane needs to be modified, and that's what I've been doing for the last 9 months. To summarize the modifications, the undercarriage has been changed, titanium gears have been fitted to make it lighter and more streamlined, and there's been serious modifications to the engine and propeller and the induction system and the fuel injection system.
And how was it flying today?
Very blustery, hard to maintain position, and I had to adapt my display slightly. But I hope you enjoyed it. It's a shame you didn't get too much footage of it. But as you can see, the modifications produce quite an impressive performance from takeoff to landing. It's a fantastic aeroplane to fly, I've only got, I first flew it again since all the modifications on the 28th of May, so I have very limited time on it at the moment, and I'm sure the display is going to get a lot better.
Well, it's a very sexy plane, so good, well done.
Well, thank you very much. Probably sexier than me.
We're here with Ted Sinclair, who is a wonderful part of a group of Norfolk enthusiasts to recreate the Titanic radio room. I'm going to ask him about the SOS signal and the Marconi radio. Ted, can you tell us the significance of the SOS signal and how it was translated through the Marconi radio?
Yes, the SOS signal that most people are familiar with was actually brought in 1906, which was 6 years before the Titanic disaster. And although Marconi, because he had his own call sign for distress, which was CQD, their operators continued to use that. And when the accident happened, they put out the messages with a CQD in front, but really they should have been using SOS all the time. Eventually one of the operators said to the other one, shall we try the new distress sign SOS, which was by no means new and they should have used in the first place. It didn't have any effect on the disaster, but the thing was, this is one of the aspects of it. But
so is it actually a term that was made famous from from the Titanic?
The SOS, yeah. Yes, I think it was, but most people were under the impression that was the first time it was used. But
yes, I was.
But it certainly wasn't, no.
Thank you so much for your information. Have a great day. Here we have Sean Hindle, who's curator of the East England Military Museum. Sean, it looks like you have an incredible army here, and I was wondering if you could take us around and just tell us some of the important vehicles that you have.
Well, we've got vehicles spanning most of the 1980s and 90s here at the moment, what the British Army have used. We've not got much World War II kit out today. We've got some stuff which is still current and still serving, extremely rare and the only stuff in private hands. But what I'll do is I'll get Steve, who's just left the army, to walk you around and tell you all about them.
I'm so excited, and I also offered to drive this baby over here, so hopefully we're going to get to do that later. Here we are with Steve Garrett, our other curator of this fantastic area, and we have this colossal artillery piece right behind us. He's going to tell us about it.
Yeah, this is the FH-70. It's a self-propelled 155mm artillery piece. Was in use with the British Army until 1995. And one of the unique pieces about this equipment is it's got its own little engine, so it can be driven into location when it's unhooked from the truck. If you look behind you, you'd see some of the older artillery pieces that we've got. They had to be manhandled into place.
Didn't you say that this has a Volkswagen engine in it?
It has. It's got a little Volkswagen petrol engine. But you can imagine the size of this thing. If you take it off the back of the truck, you'd need an awful lot of blokes to be able to manoeuvre it into position.
Exactly.
It's got its own engine. It's run on hydraulics. And it'll drive into place.
I think this is a very exciting vehicle. We also have some tiny tykes back there who are just ready to make it move.
Yeah, we always get a lot of interest on this piece when we display it, purely because of its size. It invokes interest in a lot of young lads.
I think that's fabulous. Where are you taking us to next?
Okay, behind you.
Well, I think this vehicle's very sexy. I can't wait to hear what this vehicle is actually used for.
This is a light strike vehicle. It was used initially by the SAS. This vehicle's actually got provenance that it was used in the first Gulf War. In a similarity to the great big artillery piece we were just talking about, this also runs a Volkswagen engine.
Oh my goodness, that is just so fascinating.
These things run about a nice steady 50 miles an hour cross country. They'll go pretty much anywhere you want them to. They were designed as a weapons platform. You can see above us a 50 caliber machine gun. They carry a majority of weapons that the SAS would use. Unfortunately, they got taken out of service because they couldn't carry enough equipment that the troops needed.
So you promised that I was going to be able to drive this vehicle later, and I wanted to know everything about it before I actually get in. Tell me about.
Okay, this is another artillery piece, a self-propelled gun. People mistake these as being tanks. They're not.
Oh, I thought it was. That's why we're here.
Yeah. A tank can fire in what's called the direct fire mode. These vehicles have got to stop, aim at their target, and then fire. This is an Abbott self-propelled gun, 105mm. Unfortunately, she's quite an old one. She went out of service in the late 70s, and she was replaced by a wonderful Austrian gun called the M109. Dead simple to drive. Mm-hmm. Two tillers, one pedal.
All right.
pull left to go left, pull right to go right, and just stamp on the pedal to go faster.
All right, well, I'm ready to rock and roll when you are.
I'm ready when you are. Let's go play.
All right, here we go. Hi, we are lucky enough to have Brendon O'Brien here with a scintillating personality and welcome him to the Norfolk Air Show. Brendon, please tell us about your family circus.
Tracey, first of all, great to see you, and it's wonderful to be here at Old Buckenham. Glorious sunshine, it's a little bit windy. Okay, the flying circus, it's about entertainment, and that's the key word, I guess. People come along to air shows to be entertained, and landing an airplane on top of a truck is kind of what we call flying circus. It goes back to the days of barnstorming between the wars, the 1920s and the 1930s. So it's a very old, a very great tradition. A lot of it started, of course, in your home country, in the United States of America. My show is a little bit different. It comes under the guise of barnstorming, yeah? Right. You know, landing an aeroplane on top of a truck is basically pure theatre.
And how long have you been doing this?
Ah, yes, a very good question. Now, one never asks a girl her age, but I've been doing it for nearly 50 years.
So there we go, ladies and gentlemen, the bright yellow Piper Cub, trailing smoke there from Brendon. Now, Brendon, No, Brendon, you tend to hold it still. No, that's... You'd think somebody with his experience would know better than that, but here he comes. Now, we are hoping that later on Brendon will be able to do something pretty special here, which may qualify him for a Guinness Book of Records record. But, again, the conditions are not exactly brilliant. He was saying before we started that... It was looking very, very bumpy over the trees over there, so he wasn't likely to go particularly low over there. So here he comes. Coming down the runway, pulling up, lots of wiggle on. Now here we go, we have the world's shortest runway with the world's strangest pilot. Is he going to give it a go? He's going to give it a go. He's going to try again. If he can get onto that, it will qualify as the world's shortest ever landing. He's got his wheels down. Oh, no. No, not quite. Now, instead, he's been distracted by the lesser-spotted snurd warbler again. He's going to go and have another look at that. Flying along. Is he going to give it a go? Oh, no, 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 it's Pyro. Oh, look at that. Now, I think that might be a hint that the trailer driver didn't want him to land on that pass. Got his smoke on. He's there. He's lining up. Timing the run so that he can come down level next to the trailer. Now, are we going to see something from Brendon this time? Are we? Who knows? All sorts of things could happen. Is he going to get on there? He's getting down. Oh, it's close, close, close. Oh, he's touched down. Is he going to get on there? No. Oh, just a bit too windy. That last gust came. I mean, we can all feel that gust that came through right at the end. So, unfortunately, he didn't make it. This is such a shame. So, they'll come past now for another positioning run, and the trailer will go and park up. But wave to Brendon. He's going to be... in close and waving. He'll be leaning out the window. So, talk to the organiser. Matt, is he going to be doing it next year?
Yes.
There was the voice of authority. We don't argue with Matt. He is going to be doing it next year. But that's such a shame that the weather's bad. But Brendan's, he's not bad at this, really. Next item up is going to be the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. He's running in. There's no smoke with this one. Running in right in front of the competition crowd centre is Rod Dean. He's put his landing light on in the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. Now, the Bulldog was an aeroplane that was very familiar around RAF airfields from the very early 70s right up until into the 90s. Originally designed by Beagle Aircraft, the first prototype flew in 1969 at Shoreham, and all other aircraft were subsequently built by Scottish Aviation Limited at Prestwick. So if you listen very carefully to the exhaust note, you will hear a very slight Scottish accent. Now, the Bulldog was ordered by a number of air forces as a basic trainer. These included the Swedish Air Force and Army, the air forces of Malaysia, Kenya, Ghana, Nigeria, Jordan, breathe in, Lebanon, Botswana, and the Royal Hong Kong Auxiliary Air Force. In the UK, the Royal Air Force ordered 130 as a chipmunk replacement with the University Air Squadrons and the Air Experience flights. So a lot of serving RAF air crew would have had their first air experience flights in aeroplanes very similar to, and in fact in, this aeroplane. Now, the Bulldog is a fully aerobatic aircraft with side-by-side seating, powered by a 200 horsepower Lycoming IO360 flat 4. That means it's a 360 cubic inch engine and has a constant speed Hartzell two-bladed propeller. Now, just to give you an idea what the conditions are like today, as Rob was just on short finals there, he radioed the next aeroplane and told them that it is very, very bumpy up there. So again, as he comes past, he can see. You can see how much glass he's got to look out of. He's got loads of space to see you. So give him a wave. Now, you'll be pleased to know, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to teach you to suck eggs while the Spitfire's up. I won't give you facts and figures. You can look those up. I'll try and put it in context a bit, but mostly I'm going to let you listen to it, because that is what it's all about, the wonderful noise of that Merlin engine. So, my lards, ladles, jelly moulds and chilblains, lining up at the end of the runway, we have Steve Jones in the old Flying Machine Company Spitfire Mark 9. That, of course, is one of the great sights and sounds of British air shows. Thank you for sticking with us and watching it. I know it's been testing conditions today. We would like to thank you all for coming to the 2013 Old Buckenham Air Show. Remember, there are still things to see. So on behalf of myself, Melvin Hiscock, thank you very much for coming. Stick around, see what's going on, and who knows, I may see you next year.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed what has certainly been the biggest Old Buckenham Air Show we've had to date. In the skies above at the moment, you will see not part of the main display, but more important, perhaps, our Chief Flying Instructor, Wing Commander Jerry Honey, OBE, in our most famous resident, the 1941 Boeing PT Stearman. On board is an extremely lucky Eastern Daily Press winner. Very delighted to have the EDP and Archand as our media partners, who've offered incredibly fabulous support throughout. Particularly would like to thank Steve Maddams of the EDP for his passionate support of us, and we're looking forward to doing the same next year.
We're here with the Wildcat aerobatic team, Willie Cruikshank, David Jenkins, and Al Coots. And David, how do you feel about joining this crazy team of guys?
Well, it's good fun. I've done a lot of aerobatic competition in the past, and this is the first time I've really been involved with a display team. And it's good to contrast the edge with the two pits. So I'm doing all the dynamic stuff. They're doing all the graceful precision formation stuff. And I think it works well because it keeps something in front of the audience the whole time. That's how we designed the display.
So I understand that you started with two planes, with you and Al, and then you added David, and I believe that you bought two more planes. So are you looking to expand at this point?
We have. We've got another one of these pits. It's currently red. We hope to get it painted like this by the end of the year, and the pilot's just starting his work up for that. And then we'll see where we go from there. Hopefully we'll end up with four pits, maybe four on the edge or maybe just four pits. We'll see how we get on.
Can you tell us the quick story? I know that Al is a cattle farmer and you were a group captain. How you guys actually got together? I think that's really interesting.
Well, yeah, I was in the Air Force. Al's been in the Air Force before taking up all this other stuff he's been doing. And we have a mutual friend who's an ex-Red Arrows pilot, and then he was the boss of the Battle Britain Memorial flight. And when I left the Air Force, I said, I'm coming back to Norfolk, and I want to get into this sort of flying. And he said, I've got a chum there called Al. You should speak to him. And that's where it all started. And we've been flying for about the last 2 or 3 years working up to this.
Well, this is a fantastic team. I hope you'll come out to the field and visit these three magnificent men.
In their flying machines.
And their flying machines. This is Brian, our safety manager at Old Buckenham Airfield, and I wanted to find out what a day in the life of Brian is. What was today like for you?
Today was busy, but organized.
Right.
Uneventful, which is what we're looking for.
No emergencies?
No emergencies that I'm aware of. One or two minor incidents, but nothing to be alarmed about.
All right. Well, if you have this man in your corner, you know you're safe. So thank you for being with us today.
You're absolutely welcome.
Here we are at the United States Army Air Force Memorial, Station 144. Think back to December 1943. Jimmy Stewart, Hollywood film legend, was actually an executive officer here, as well as Walter Matthau. This memorial is to commemorate the 366 men that lost their lives at Old Buckenham. This is a beautiful memorial. We hope you come and visit it. Well, it's the end of our weekend. I'm absolutely windswept. I'm rained on. I had the most fantastic time. I hope I showed you a good time. And we look forward to seeing you in 2014. Thanks for being here. Bye.
Victories of the ceremony. Later, so is the winning.
at them, so good for them.
Hi, we're here with Steve Jones, who's just flown in the most famous plane in the world, the MH-434 Spitfire. You've probably seen this plane in A Bridge Too Far, Battle of Britain, and Hope and Glory, and he's graciously flown it in the most fabulous way. This is pretty much like a museum piece. Are you ever worried about flying this plane?
I'm always worried about flying this airplane. I mean, it's such a fantastic piece of aviation history. But yeah, so you have to be super careful with it, but it's a marvellous machine, you know, 1943 Mark 9 Spitfire, and pretty much as it is here today, it's pretty much as it was in 1943, so it's an absolute artifact, treasured artifact.
How is it that it's 70 years old and it's actually flying so vigorously, more than most?
Well, I think because people look after it very well. I mean, it's got a long history of being owned by and operated by the Hanna family, Ray Hanna, Mark Hanna. Mm-hmm. So they looked after it very well, but also flew it very, you know, beautifully and aggressively as it should have been flown. But they've just looked after it very well, and we're trying to do the same thing, look after it just as well as they did.
What do you love about the 27-litre engine?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's one of the loveliest piston engines ever built. Sadly, unless you're in the thing, you don't get to hear the real noise of it, but it's marvellous, little tiny short exhaust stubs, so great. One of the nicest things is starting the engine and hearing that Merlin growl.
The Rolls-Royce Merlin, correct?
The Rolls-Royce Merlin.
I know my planes. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Now, smoke on, he's rolling in, accelerating in towards us. Now watch as he comes, he's bound to use the roll rate. Yes, there he is, rolling it in on the way in. Having wound it up, he wound it back the other way. Accelerating hard down, now to around about 200 odd mile an hour. Pulling hard at the bottom.
Richard Goodwin, who's been flying for 33 years, and he's going to tell us about his Pitts S2S. Richard, about 3 weeks ago, was this actually on the garage floor?
In quite a few bits, yes, on the garage floor. I'll just give you a bit of a brief history and resume of the aeroplane.
Please.
I bought it 9 months ago, specifically with the intention of modifying it for the UK airshow circuit. It's very popular in America, flown by a couple of very good aerobatic pilots, and it produces an exceptional display, but the aeroplane needs to be modified, and that's what I've been doing for the last 9 months. To summarise the modifications, the undercarriage has been changed, titanium gears have been fitted to make it lighter and more streamlined, and there's been serious modifications to the engine and propeller and the induction system and the fuel injection system.
And how was it flying today?
Very blustery, hard to maintain position, and I had to adapt my display slightly. But I hope you enjoyed it. It's a shame you didn't get too much footage of it, but as you can see, the modifications produce quite an impressive performance from takeoff to landing. It's a fantastic aeroplane to fly. I've only got, I first flew it again since all the modifications on the 28th of May, so I have very limited time on it at the moment, and I'm sure the display is going to get a lot better.
Well, it's a very sexy plane, so good, well done.
Well, thank you very much. Probably sexier than me.
We're here with Ted Sinclair, who is a wonderful part of a group of Norfolk enthusiasts to recreate the Titanic radio room. I'm going to ask him about the SOS signal and the Marconi radio. Ted, can you tell us the significance of the SOS signal and how it was translated through the Marconi radio?
Yes, the SOS signal that most people are familiar with was actually brought in 1906, which was 6 years before the Titanic disaster. And although Marconi, because he had his own call sign for distress, which was CQD, their operators continued to use that. And when the accident happened, they put out the messages with the CQD in front, but really they should have been using SOS all the time. Eventually one of the operators said to the other one, shall we try the new distress sign SOS, which was by no means new and they should have used in the first place. It didn't have any effect on the disaster, but the thing was, this is one of the aspects of it. But
so is it actually a term that was made famous from from the Titanic?
The SOS, yeah. Yes, I think it was. But most people were under the impression that was the first time it was used. But
yes, I was.
But it certainly wasn't, no.
Thank you so much for your information. Have a great day. Here we have Sean Hindle, who's curator of the East England Military Museum. Sean, it looks like you have an incredible army here, and I was wondering if you could take us around and just tell us some of the important vehicles that you have.
Well, we've got vehicles spanning most of the 1980s and 90s here at the moment, what the British Army have used. We've not got much World War II kit out today. We've got some stuff which is still current and still serving, extremely rare and the only stuff in private hands. But what I'll do is I'll get Steve, who's just left the army, to walk you around and tell you all about him.
I'm so excited, and I also offered to drive this baby over here, so hopefully we're going to get to do that later. Here we are with Steve Garrett, our other curator of this fantastic area, and we have this colossal artillery piece right behind us. He's going to tell us about it.
Yeah, this is the FH-70. It's a self-propelled 155mm artillery piece. Was in use with the British Army until 1995. And one of the unique pieces about this equipment is it's got its own little engine, so it can be driven into location when it's unhooked from the truck. If you look behind you, you'd see some of the older artillery pieces that we've got. They had to be manhandled into place.
Didn't you say that this has a Volkswagen engine in it?
It has. It's got a little Volkswagen petrol engine. But you can imagine the size of this thing. If you take it off the back of the truck, you'd need an awful lot of blokes to be able to manoeuvre it into position.
Exactly.
It's got its own engine. It's run on hydraulics. And it'll drive into place.
I think this is a very exciting vehicle. We also have some tiny tykes back there who are just ready to make it move.
Yeah, we always get a lot of interest on this piece when we display it. Purely because of its size, it invokes interest in a lot of young lads.
I think that's fabulous. Where are you taking us to next?
Okay, behind you.
Well, I think this vehicle's very sexy. I can't wait to hear what this vehicle is actually used for.
This is a light strike vehicle. It was used initially by the SAS. This vehicle's actually got provenance that it was used in the first Gulf War. in a similarity to the great big artillery piece we were just talking about, this also runs a Volkswagen engine.
Oh my goodness, that is just so fascinating.
These things run about a nice steady 50 miles an hour cross country. They'll go pretty much anywhere you want them to. They were designed as a weapons platform. You can see above us, 50 caliber machine gun. They carry a majority of weapons that the SAS would use. Unfortunately, they got taken out of service because they couldn't carry enough equipment that the troops needed.
So you promised that I was going to be able to drive this vehicle later, and I wanted to know everything about it before I actually get in. Tell me about...
Okay, this is another artillery piece. A self-propelled gun. People mistake these as being tanks. They're not.
Oh, I thought it was. That's why we're here.
Yeah. A tank can fire in what's called the direct fire mode. These vehicles have got to stop, aim at their target, and then fire. This is an Abbott self-propelled gun, 105mm. Unfortunately, she's quite an old one. She went out of service in the late 70s, and she was replaced by a wonderful Austrian gun called the M109. Dead simple to drive. Mm-hmm. Two tillers, one pedal. Pull left to go left, pull right to go right, and just stamp on the pedal to go faster.
All right, well, I'm ready to rock and roll when you are.
I'm ready when you are. Let's go play.
All right, here we go. Hi, we are lucky enough to have Brendon O'Brien here with a scintillating personality, and welcome him to the Norfolk Air Show. Brendon, please tell us about your family circus.
Tracy, first of all, great to see you, and it's wonderful to be here at Old Buckenham. Glorious sunshine, it's a little bit windy. Okay, the flying circus, it's about entertainment, and that's the key word, I guess. People come along to air shows to be entertained, and landing an airplane on top of a truck is kind of what we call flying circus. It goes back to the days of barnstorming between the wars, the 1920s and the 1930s. So it's a very old, a very great tradition. A lot of it started, of course, in your home country, in the United States of America. My show is a little bit different. It comes under the guise of barnstorming, yeah? Right. You know, landing an aeroplane on top of a truck is basically pure theatre.
And how long have you been doing this?
Ah, yes, a very good question. Now, one never asks a girl her age, but I've been doing it for nearly 50 years.
So there we go, ladies and gentlemen, the bright yellow Piper Cub, trailing smoke there from Brendon. Now, Brendon, No, Brendon, you tend to hold it still. No, that's... You'd think somebody with his experience would know better than that, but here he comes. Now, we are hoping that later on Brendon will be able to do something pretty special here, which may qualify him for a Guinness Book of Records record. But, again, the conditions are not exactly brilliant. He was saying before we started that... it was looking very, very bumpy over the trees over there, so he wasn't likely to go particularly low over there. So here he comes. Coming down the runway, pulling up, lots of wiggle on. Now here we go, we have the world's shortest runway with the world's strangest pilot. Is he going to give it a go? He's going to give it a go. He's going to try and get... If he can get onto that, it will qualify as the world's shortest ever landing. He's got his wheels down. Oh, no. No, not quite. No, instead, he's been distracted by the lesser-spotted snurd warbler again. He's going to go and have another look at that. Flying along. Is he going to give it a go? Oh, no, 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 it's Pyro. Oh, look at that. Now, I think that might be a hint that the trailer driver didn't want him to land on that pass. Got his smoke on. He's there. He's lining up. Timing the run so that he can come down level next to the the trailer. Now, are we going to see something from Brendon this time? Are we? Who knows? All sorts of things could happen. Is he going to get on there? He's getting down. Oh, close, close, close. Oh, he's touched down. Is he going to get on it? No. Oh, just a bit too windy. That last gust came. I mean, we can all feel that, that gust that came through right at the end. So, unfortunately, he didn't make it. This is such a shame. So, they'll come past now for another positioning run, and the trailer will go and park up. But wave to Brendon. He's going to be in close and waving. He'll be leaning out the window. So, talk to the organiser. Matt, is he going to be doing it next year?
Yes.
There was the voice of authority. We don't argue with Matt. He is going to be doing it next year. But that's such a shame that the weather's bad. But Brendon's, he's not bad at this, really. Next item up is going to be the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. He's running in. There's no smoke with this one. Running in right in front of the commentary position. Crowd centre is Rod Dean. He's put his landing light on in the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. Now, the Bulldog was an aeroplane that was very familiar around RAF airfields from the very early 70s right up until into the 90s. Originally designed by Beagle Aircraft, the first prototype flew in 1969 at Shoreham, and all other aircraft were subsequently built by Scottish Aviation Limited at Prestwick. So if you listen very carefully to the exhaust note, you will hear a very slight Scottish accent. Now, the Bulldog was ordered by a number of air forces as a basic trainer. These included the Swedish Air Force and Army, the air forces of Malaysia, Kenya, Ghana, Nigeria, Jordan, breathe in, Lebanon, Botswana, and the Royal Hong Kong Auxiliary Air Force. In the UK, the Royal Air Force ordered 130 as a chipmunk replacement with the University Air Squadrons and the Air Experience flights. So a lot of serving RAF air crew would have had their first air experience flights in aeroplanes very similar to, and in fact in, this aeroplane. Now, the Bulldog is a fully aerobatic aircraft with side-by-side seating, powered by a 200 horsepower Lycoming IO360 flat 4. That means it's a 360 cubic inch engine and has a constant speed Hartzell two-bladed propeller. Now, just to give you an idea what the conditions are like today, as Rob was just on short finals there, he radioed the next aeroplane and told them that it is very, very bumpy up there. So again, as he comes past, he can see. You can see how much glass he's got to look out of. He's got loads of space to see you. So give him a wave. Now, you'll be pleased to know, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to teach you to suck eggs while the Spitfire's up. I won't give you facts and figures. You can look those up. I'll try and put it in context a bit, but mostly I'm going to let you listen to it, because that is what it's all about, the wonderful noise of that Merlin engine. So, my lards, ladles, jelly moulds and chilblains, lining up at the end of the runway, we have Steve Jones in the old flying machine company Spitfire Mark 9. That, of course, is one of the great sights and sounds of British air shows. Thank you for sticking with us and watching it. I know it's been testing conditions today. We would like to thank you all for coming to the 2013 Old Buckenham Air Show. Remember, there are still things to see. So on behalf of myself, Melvin Hiscock, thank you very much for coming. Stick around, see what's going on, and who knows, I may see you next year.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed what has certainly been the biggest Old Buckenham Air Show we've had to date. In the skies above at the moment, you will see not part of the main display, but more important, perhaps, our Chief Flying Instructor, Wing Commander Jerry Honey, OBE, in our most famous resident, the 1941 Boeing PT Stearman. On board is an extremely lucky Eastern Daily Press winner. Very delighted to have the EDP and Archand as our media partners, who've offered incredibly fabulous support throughout. Particularly would like to thank Steve Maddams of the EDP for his passionate support of us, and we're looking forward to doing the same next year.
We're here with the Wildcat aerobatic team, Willie Cruikshank, David Jenkins, and Al Coots. And David, how do you feel about joining this crazy team of guys?
Well, it's good fun. I've done a lot of aerobatic competition in the past, and this is the first time I've really been involved with a display team. And it's good to contrast the edge with the two pits. So I'm doing all the dynamic stuff. They're doing all the graceful precision formation stuff. And I think it works well because it keeps something in front of the audience the whole time. That's how we designed the display.
So I understand that you started with two planes, with you and Al, and then you added David, and I believe that you bought two more planes. So are you looking to expand at this point?
We have. We've got another one of these pits. It's currently red. Hope to get it painted like this by the end of the year, and the pilot's just starting his work up for that. And then we'll see where we go from there. Hopefully we'd end up with four pits, maybe four on the edge, or maybe just four pits. We'll see how we get on.
Can you tell us the quick story? I know that Al is a cattle farmer, and you were a group captain. How you guys actually got together? I think that's really interesting.
Well, yeah, I was in the Air Force. Al's been in the Air Force before before taking up all this other stuff he's been doing. And we have a mutual friend who's an expert Arrows pilot, and then he was the boss of the Battle Britain Memorial flight. And when I left the Air Force, I said, I'm coming back to Norfolk, and I want to get into this sort of flying. And he said, I've got a chum there called Al. You should speak to him. And that's where it all started. And we've been flying for about the last 2 or 3 years working up to this.
Well, this is a fantastic team. I hope you'll come out to the field and visit these three magnificent men.
In their flying machines.
And their flying machines. This is Brian, our safety manager at Old Buckenham Airfield, and I wanted to find out what a day in the life of Brian is. What was today like for you?
Today was busy, but organized.
Right.
Uneventful, which is what we're looking for.
No emergencies?
No emergencies that I'm aware of. One or two minor incidents, but nothing to be alarmed about.
All right. Well, if you have this man in your corner, you know you're safe. So thank you for being with us today.
You're absolutely welcome.
Here we are at the United States Army Air Force Memorial, Station 144. Think back to December 1943. Jimmy Stewart, Hollywood film legend, was actually an executive officer here, as well as Walter Matthau. This memorial is to commemorate the 366 men that lost their lives at Old Buckenham. This is a beautiful memorial. We hope you come and visit it. Well, it's the end of our weekend. I'm absolutely windswept. I'm rained on. I had the most fantastic time. I hope I showed you a good time. And we look forward to seeing you in 2014. Thanks for being here. Bye.
Now, I think that might be a hint that the trailer driver didn't want him to land on that pass. Got his smoke on, he's there, he's lining up. Timing the run so that he can come down level next to the trailer. Now, are we going to see something from Brendon this time? Are we? Who knows? All sorts of things could happen. Is he going to get on there? He's getting down. Oh, close, close, close. Oh, he's touched down. Is he going to get on there? No. Oh, just a bit too windy. That last gust came. I mean, we can all feel that, that gust that came through right at the end. So, unfortunately, he didn't make it. This is such a shame. So, they'll come past now for another positioning run, and the trailer will go and park up. But wave to Brendon. He's going to be in close and waving. He'll be leaning out the window. So, talk to the organizer. Matt, is he going to be doing it next year?
Yes.
There was the voice of authority. We don't argue with Matt. He is going to be doing it next year. But that's such a shame that the weather's bad. But Brendon's, he's not bad at this, really. Next item up is going to be the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. He's running in. There's no smoke with this one. Running in right in front of the commentary position. Crowd centre is Rod Dean. He's put his landing light on in the Scottish Aviation Bulldog. Now, the Bulldog was an aeroplane that was very familiar around RAF airfields from the very early 70s right up until into the 90s. Originally designed by Beagle Aircraft. The first prototype flew in 1969 at Shoreham. And all other aircraft were subsequently built by Scottish Aviation Limited at Prestwick. So if you listen very carefully to the exhaust note, you will hear a very slight Scottish accent. Now, the Bulldog was ordered by a number of air forces as a basic trainer. These included the Swedish Air Force and Army, the air forces of Malaysia, Kenya, Ghana, Nigeria, Jordan, breathe in, Lebanon, Botswana, and the Royal Hong Kong Auxiliary Air Force. In the UK, the Royal Air Force ordered 130 as a chipmunk replacement with the University Air Squadrons and the Air Experience flights. So a lot of serving RAF air crew would have had their first air experience flights in aeroplanes very similar to, and in fact in, this aeroplane. Now, the Bulldog is a fully aerobatic aircraft with side-by-side seating, powered by a 200 horsepower Lycoming IO360 flat 4. That means it's a 360 cubic inch engine and has a constant speed Hartzell two-bladed propeller. Now, just to give you an idea what the conditions are like today, as Rob was just on short finals there, he radioed the next aeroplane and told them that it is very, very bumpy up there. So again, as he comes past, he can see. You can see how much glass he's got to look out of. He's got loads of space to see you. So give him a wave. Now, you'll be pleased to know, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to teach you to suck eggs while the Spitfire's up. I won't give you facts and figures. You can look those up. I'll try and put it in context a bit, but mostly I'm going to let you listen to it, because that is what it's all about, the wonderful noise of that Merlin engine. So My lards, ladles, jelly molds and chilblains. Lining up at the end of the runway, we have Steve Jones in the old flying machine company, Spitfire Mark 9. Of course, is one of the great sights and sounds of British air shows. Thank you for sticking with us and watching it. I know it's been testing conditions today. We would like to thank you all for coming to the 2013 Old Buckenham Air Show. Remember, there are still things to see. So on behalf of myself, Melvin Hiscock, thank you very much for coming. Stick around, see what's going on, and who knows, I may see you next year.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed what has certainly been the biggest Old Buckenham Air Show we've had to date. In the skies above at the moment, you will see not part of the main display, but more important, perhaps, our Chief Flying Instructor, Wing Commander Jerry Honey, OBE, in our most famous resident, the 1941 Boeing PT Stim. And on board is an extremely lucky Eastern Daily Press winner. Very delighted to have the EDP and Archand as our media partners, who've offered incredibly fabulous support throughout. Particularly would like to thank Steve Maddams of the EDP for his passionate support of us, and we're looking forward to doing the same next year.
We're here with the Wildcat aerobatic team, Willie Cruikshank, David Jenkins, and Al Coots. And David, how do you feel about joining this crazy team of guys?
Well, it's good fun. I've done a lot of aerobatic competition in the past, and this is the first time I've really been involved with a display team. And it's good to contrast the edge with the two pits. So I'm doing all the dynamic stuff. They're doing all the graceful precision formation stuff. And I think it works well because it keeps something in front of the audience the whole time. That's how we designed the display.
So I understand that you started with two planes, with you and Al, and then you added David, and I believe that you bought two more planes. So are you looking to expand at this point?
We have. We've got another one of these pits. It's currently red. Hope to get it painted like this by the end of the year, and the pilot's just starting his work up for that. And then we'll see where we go from there. Hopefully we'd end up with four pits, maybe four on the edge, or maybe just four pits. We'll see how we get on.
Can you tell us the quick story? I know that Al is a cattle farmer, and you were a group captain. How you guys actually got together? I think that's really interesting.
Well, yeah, I was in the Air Force. Al's been in the Air Force before taking up all this other stuff he's been doing, and we have a mutual friend who's an expert Arrows pilot, and then he was the boss of the Battle Britain Memorial flight. And when I left the Air Force, I said, I'm coming back to Norfolk and I want to get into this sort of flying, and he said, I've got a chum there called Al, you should speak to him. And that's where it all started, and we've been flying for about the last 2 or 3 years working up to this.
Well, this is a fantastic team. I hope you'll come out to the field and visit these three magnificent men.
In their flying machines.
And their flying machines. This is Brian, our safety manager at Old Buckenham Airfield, and I wanted to find out what a day in the life of Brian is. What was today like for you?
Today was busy, but organized.
Right.
Uneventful, which is what we're looking for.
No emergencies?
No emergencies that I'm aware of. One or two minor incidents, but nothing to be alarmed about.
All right. Well, if you have this man in your corner, you know you're safe. So thank you for being with us today.
You're absolutely welcome.
Here we are at the United States Army Air Force Memorial, Station 144. Think back to December 1943. Jimmy Stewart, Hollywood film legend, was actually an executive officer here, as well as Walter Matthau. This memorial is to commemorate the 366 men that lost their lives at Old Buckenham. This is a beautiful memorial. We hope you come and visit it. Well, it's the end of our weekend. I'm absolutely windswept. I'm rained on. I had the most fantastic time. I hope I showed you a good time. And we look forward to seeing you in 2014. Thanks for being here. Bye.